In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to create a super cool vintage badge. Designs like this give your animations a retro vibe, and who doesn't like retro? We'll be going over shape layers, text animators, layer styles, and I'll show you how to track text to a mask. There are a lot of techniques in this tutorial that are applicable to other animations, and I guarantee you will learn something useful. As always, there are a ton of tips, tricks, and shortcuts. There's a lot to get through, so let's dive right in. Okay, so let's right-click in this area that's to the left of our timeline and add in a new shape layer. Just want to call this badge. Open up our shape layer, go to the add button, and let's add in a group. And within that group, we're going to add in an ellipse, and we're going to give that ellipse a fill. So let's change our fill setting from red to white. Open up our ellipse path, increase our ellipse path size to 480. And then let's go ahead and add in one more effect. We're going to add in a zigzag. So we want to make our size set to 8, and our points, we're going to make those smooth. And actually, let's go ahead and increase this a little bit bigger. We'll make it maybe 800. And we can open up our zigzag again and increase that a little bit, so size 15. Okay, so let's close up that group, and we want to duplicate that. Open up our settings, get rid of our zigzag. And then we can change our fill color now. So I'm going to go with something kind of vintage. A nice vintage color, something like a muted brown or muted blue. Okay, so I'm going to decrease my ellipse path size now to so it fits in about like that. I'm going to make this an exact amount because we're going to be animating this and it just makes the math a little bit easier. So we'll say maybe 720. Okay, close up group two. Let's duplicate that. Open up our settings here. Let's get rid of our fill. But then we want to add in a stroke. See how the stroke went down to the very bottom right here underneath our groups? That's because it didn't have group 3 selected. So whenever you have multiple groups and you want to add in effects, make sure you're adding it into the proper group like that. Okay, and our ellipse path size, we'll make this a little bit smaller. So we'll say 640. Let me see, I may make my stroke, we'll say maybe 4 instead of 2. Okay, then we're going to duplicate group 3. And then we're going to get rid of this stroke, select group 4. And then add in a fill and see how it drops right in there underneath our ellipse path size. And I want to make this like a really muted, maybe like a blue, something that's just kind of got that old kind of feel to it. And then let's open up our ellipse path size settings. This may be like our centerpiece. Let's just kind of put it right in here. And actually, you know what? I do want to add in a stroke. So if you deleted that stroke, put one back in. And we're just going to leave the stroke setting at 2. And white, so that way we kind of have this outline right around that middle piece. So this is our badge, and you know what? I may increase this group 2 here, so you know, you may make some changes as you're going through this. Just get it to the kind of look that you like, where it fits about right. There are really no rules to this. Okay, so now I want to animate this in. So if you select this layer, go to your finder here, you can type in size, and all of your size settings will pop up. So that's a nice shortcut. If you're ever looking for something very specific within a group or a layer, go to this finder toolbar. I use it all the time to find all kinds of properties. And now, so this is going to be a 3 keyframe animation. We're just going to kind of overshoot and come back. So I'm going to go ahead and put keyframes for all of these. Shift page down once to go forward 10 frames. We're just going to add in another keyframe. And then shift page down one more time to go forward another 10 frames. And one last keyframe. Obviously, these last set of keyframes is where we're going to end. So we want these middle keyframes to be our overshoot. And whenever I do overshoots, depending on the size of my shapes, I just increase it maybe 20 to 50 pixels, depending on how big you want the bounce to be. So see, this one ends at 483. I'll just make this maybe like 510. This one's 640. Maybe we'll make that one 680. 750, we can make that maybe 775, just to give it some randomness. This one's 800, maybe we'll do that one 825, or actually we can make that a little bit bigger. We'll say maybe 840. This first set of keyframes, these all need to be set to 0, because we want them to animate on. So let's select these last 2 keyframes on all of these size settings, F9 to make those easy ease. Select these middle keyframes, go to your graph editor, which is right here, and kind of push in here and just pull these handles away from that middle keyframe like that. Go back out to our timeline and we can see this is how it's going to kind of come in. Kind of has a little bit of a bounce to it. Now you may want your bounce to be a little bit more exaggerated. Just kind of mess with these middle values here. See, I may kind of increase this a little bit. We'll say 530, maybe 700, maybe 810, and then maybe 880. So it kind of has more of a bounce. So now we need to offset these keyframes. I'm going to offset them by 3 frames each. So page down, 1, 2, 3. Page down goes forward 1 frame. Shift page down goes forward 10. Page down, 1, 2, 3. scooch these over, and then 1, 2, 3. Leave this right. Yep. So like this. Once you come in, and we kind of have this kind of a bounce to it, just like that. Okay, so now I need to add in that text that goes around our shape layer here. So I'm going to go ahead and close up this badge layer in Command or Control T to bring up your text tool. And I'm going to type vintage with a bullet coming before and after it. And if you're on a Mac, to do a bullet, it's Option 8. And then I'm going to type vintage. And actually, I need to make this a lot bigger. I'm not sure if that bullet came in. We'll say Option 8. And then Option 8 after it. And let's just increase this so that way it's bigger. And I want to make sure these are all caps. So now if you're on a PC, the shortcut to make a bullet is holding down the Alt key and then on your number pad, do the sequence 0149. So hold down Alt, then the sequence 0149. Because now we need to center up this text. So we want to hold down Command or Control, double click the pan around tool, and we just go to our line panel and align that right up. We're going to grab our shape tool here. We want it for an ellipse. So I'm going to kind of push in here. If you hold down Shift and Command and you put your cursor right here on top of this anchor point and hold down your left mouse button and just stretch out like that, you'll get a perfect circle right from the middle, which is exactly what we want. Let's open up our text options here. Path options defaults to none. Let's make that mask 1. I'm going to put the first text on top. And the way we do that is this reverse path, change it to on. Now we can take our first margin value here and just move it around so that way it sits right on top. Click S for scale and just scale this down so it fits right in here. Go back to our character panel. Maybe we'll make the actual character smaller. So just kind of tweak between your size settings and your character settings to get the look that you want. Now I'm going to take my tracking tool right here and just kind of spread this out. Command or Control D. And we want this to go underneath. Okay, so I'm going to open my path options, reverse path. Let's put this back to off. And then let's move this around. You can set your first margin actually to 0. It'll be right at the bottom. Now, the reason why I did the reverse path on the first time is because we need to add something to this layer. See, if I bring up my position and just move this down, it doesn't quite work because, as you can see, our path here won't be around our circle. And that mask may be kind of hard to see. So one trick you may not know of is if you click M for mask, you can actually change the color of your mask. So I'm going to do something where it kind of pops out a little bit better. If we use our position to move this down, you can see that now it's not going to be on our path correctly. So I'm just going to bring up my position again and move that back up to 540 so it's centered. So the way we're going to get our text down there is to add in a position text animator. So we go to animate, position, and I'm going to rename this animator to location because I'll actually be animating this text in with text animators. I don't want there to be any confusion. So now you can move the position down just like that using your text animator. And as you can kind of see, if you come up or down, it's going to kind of mess with your tracking. So you can just kind of eyeball this, maybe go back over to your tracking and kind of bring it in a little bit so that way it matches the top text up there. So now we need to animate this in using text animators. So we're going to leave that location alone. Go to your animate button, add in a position, and we want this to come in from the right like that. So let's open all these settings up. I'm going to change it from square to ramp up, which is going to make our range from negative 100 to 100%. So I'm going to go negative 100%. If you select the left bracket, it will bring your layer over to where your playhead is. So I'm going to go ahead and move that over because this won't animate in until we get to this point. So let's set a keyframe for negative 100%. Shift page down 1, 2 times to go for 20 frames. Make that 100%. And then I want to add in a few more text animators because we want this to come on from a 0 opacity. And the way we do that, select this animator 1 and go to add. And let's add in an opacity. And then we'll make that value 0. And I want to add in one more thing. Go to add. Let's add in a blur. So now what I like to do whenever I have this blur is instead of just making this value 100, because see these values are constrained if I type in 100, it blurs the whole word out. If you just make this first value 100, so unconstrain that, make this value 100, 0, it gives you a horizontal blur, which is kind of cool. So you get something like that. I'm going to base this on words instead of characters, and then I'm going to change my ease low to 100%. Think of ease low as ease in and ease high as ease out. So if we watch that play back, that's exactly what we want right there. Okay, so now we can close all this stuff up. But before I close up this layer, I want to select Animator 1 and copy that. So Command or Control C. It's going to this other vintage layer and again left bracket to bring it over. Now I can Command or Control V to paste it. So now we have the same text animator on both. But I want this top vintage to come in from the left. So we have to make a few changes. So I'm going to open up these settings. First change we have to do is change this position. So we can see it's set to 269. Just make that a negative. So negative 269. So now it comes in from left to right. I'm not crazy about how that comes in. As you can see, it comes in from the first character, then the word, then the last character. I want that second dot to come in first, then vintage, then the first dot. So the way we fix that is really simple. Open up a range selector, open up our advanced, and then change the shape from ramp up to ramp down. Select these keyframes, right click, keyframe assistant, time reverse. So now it's going to come in from the left. Okay, so let's go ahead and close all of this up. Okay, and then left bracket to bring the layers over to where my playhead is. Watch that play back, and that looks good to me. So now I just need to make the vintage text that sits on top. Command or Control T to bring up your text tool, and we're going to type in vintage. So now I have a special font for this, and I will include both of these fonts in the project files, so that way you have those if you're going to follow along. As you can see, my font is set to Gilroy Regular, is what I used for the other text. I'm going to use a font called Groovy. So Groovy Script. I'm going to choose that. And now I want to make sure that these are not set to all caps. I want to put my tracking back down to zero and increase this. Holding down Command or Control, double click your pan around tool to center that anchor point. And we want to align this right to the middle. R for rotation, and let's rotate that negative 10 degrees. And then go back over to our character control panel. Let's just italicize that. So it sits kind of like that. Increase this a little bit. So you can put this text anywhere you want. Depending on what text you actually use, you're going to have a different size anyway. Okay, now I'm going to change my text color, maybe like a pale blue. Okay, so now I want to give this a really cool vintagey kind of look. And in order to do that, I need to add in quite a few layer styles. So right click, layer styles. We're going to go drop shadow, right click, layer styles, inner shadow, right click, layer styles, inner glow. Right click, layer styles, bevel and emboss, and then right click, layer styles, stroke. Okay, so let's just go from bottom to top. So I'm going to change this color to maybe like a little bit of a light purple. Sometimes whenever you use layer styles in previous projects, your settings will carry over. So make sure you have your size set to 3 and to outside if you want to follow along exactly with what I'm doing. Open up bevel and emboss, and I'm just going to change this size setting to 4. Okay, so for inner glow settings, we're going to make quite a few changes here. We want to change our opacity to 25%. We want our technique to be precise, our source to be center, and then we want our size to be 50. Let's close that up, go to inner shadow, change our distance from 5 to 20, so we kind of get a bit of a shadow around the edges. For our drop shadow, we want to make this white. Change our blend mode from multiply to normal, because we want to actually use a drop shadow to kind of get an extrusion on this text. And let's just change our size down to 0 so that way there's no softness whatsoever, and just increase our distance so we kind of have something where this kind of sits right on top. Make sure your opacity is set to 100%, so that way it's just pure white. Okay, so we want this to come in after this other vintage text comes in, so maybe about right here. So I got my playhead, we'll say at 1 second, 5 frames, left bracket to bring that over, S for scale, and we're going to do that 3-keyframe animation again. So we're going to put a keyframe, shift page down once, another keyframe, shift page down one more time, and a last keyframe. And then I'm going to go back to this middle one and increase this, we'll say to 120. If you hit I, it will go to the beginning of the layer. And then let's just make that first keyframe 0. So again, we want to select these last 2 keyframes and then go F9 to make those easy ease. Select this middle keyframe, go to the graph editor and pull those handles apart. So now we see how that's going to kind of pop in. So I'm going to loop this area by selecting N. Watch it play back. So that's pretty much what we're going for. For this badge here, I want this outer ridge part where we have our zigzag. I want that to kind of move around a little bit. Go to our contents. It's this group 1 right here where we have our zigzag. If you want the transform properties of group 1, option, click onto rotation and just type time times 15. That will spin that outer group. Okay, and whenever I use shape layers in text, I am a big fan of motion blur. I know Ben Marriott isn't always a fan of motion blur. I saw a tutorial where he talked about it, said you don't always have to use it. I'm a huge fan of it. So I'm just going to enable all my motion blur. And that's how you create an animated vintage badge. I'd like to thank the good folks over at AE Juice for sponsoring this video. If you haven't checked them out at aejuice.com, I highly recommend you do just that right now. Get tons of free plugins from AE Juice that will save time while adding polish and professionalism to your projects. Get the AE Juice Starter Pack, which contains over 100 assets for your projects, including liquid and shape elements, liquid transitions, slides for your slideshows, text presets, flat icons, 2D and 3D assets, and so much more. AE Juice also offers professionally produced sound effects absolutely free. Other free plugins include a HUD package that is super cool. These elements would literally take hours to create, but with AE Juice, you get them absolutely free and they can be dropped into your project with the click of a button. Some of my personal favorite free plugins include Copy Ease, which allows you to copy the speed graph of your keyframes and paste them so you get identical keyframe speeds. I also use Shifter on a regular basis. Instead of going through the multiple steps of offsetting layers, this plugin allows you to do it with the click of a button, which saves a tremendous amount of time. In addition to these impressive free plugins, you can also purchase advanced products at more than reasonable prices. Take advantage of AE Juice's bundles. My personal recommendation is that you get the I Want It All bundle, which includes everything I just showed you. I've been approached by several sponsors and I will not promote their products unless I support them, use them, and highly recommend them. AE Juice is an amazing product and company, and in my opinion, it's a necessity for any serious motion graphic designer. AEJuice.com. I hope this tutorial helped you out and that you learned something new and useful. Make sure to come back next time for another tutorial that will expand your knowledge of After Effects while also teaching you some really cool tips, tricks, and shortcuts. Please comment, like, share, and subscribe, and click the bell so you're notified every time I upload a new video. Support our channel by getting your 7-minute AE merch today at our online store. And sign up for my Udemy course, The Power of Shape Layers, is guaranteed to make you a shape layer rockstar. The link to that course, to our 7-minute AE store, and the project files for this episode are all in the description below. As always, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.